if you only use strategies once stress and anxiety have started, you've waited too long. But that's not a sustainable long-term approach. What you want to start with is preventative things. You want to do things that are going to, so I call these lifestyle decisions or lifestyle design. You need to design your life in such a way that creates a general level of background balance in your system. Because if you don't have that, you're going to be more susceptible to tipping into stress and anxiety. And so the simplest thing when I work with students and even when I work with adults is the sleep-wake cycle. Are you going to bed and waking up at the same time every day? Because that's the most important thing. That will determine when your body is trained and habituated to be alert and when it's trained and habituated to be calm and go to sleep. And what we see in our culture is that there's a total, that regulation pattern of being alert when we wake up through midday and slowly declining in the afternoon and then hitting a low before bed. And then we effortlessly fall into sleep and then the cycle starts again. That's the natural cycle. But what we see in our culture is we're so dysregulated with our habits. We so poorly manage our lifestyle that we wake up tired instead of alert, and we go to bed anxious instead of calm. And when do we tend to use substances to manage our internal state the most? In the morning, we use caffeine because we're waking up tired instead of alert. And so we have to close the gap. And at the end of the day, we use sedatives and depressants because we're anxious and we need to be calm. And so we take those things to close the gap. As long as that's going on, you're going to be more prone to dysregulation. You're going to be more prone to stress and anxiety. And so the first foundational consideration is designing your life in a way where you are getting good quality sleep and you're waking up and going to bed at about the same time every day. And this is something that's very hard for young adults because their lifestyle and their internal hormones, everything's just all over the place.
The mix.
It's very hard to create effective long-term stress management protocols when you aren't regulated in that basic way of the sleep-wake cycle. And then you can add on top of that, getting enough physical activity during the day, eating well, getting meaningful social connection, so on and so forth. So all of that's prevention. Then when you talk about intervention, stress intervention, so not just preventing it, but once I'm out of 4, 5, 6, and now I'm stressed out. Okay. I think, as I said before, I think breathing is the best strategy because you're always already doing it. I always say
to my every time you mention breathing, I realize I'm breathing. I'm like, all right, take one more breath.
I tell students, I ask them, I said, raise your hand if you left your breath at the last class that you were in, right? So the beautiful thing about breathing is it's the first thing that responds to stress. So how we live is how we breathe, and how we breathe represents how we live. It's a big cycle. And since our breath is always with us, it becomes a perfect opportunity to change our internal state through our breathing. Okay. So that's one. I also said physical activity is super helpful, but you can't always move. Taking that math test, you can't get up and start doing jumping jacks or just rip out some push-ups.
Yeah, correct. Unfortunately, not yet.
I mean, maybe you could work that out with your professor or a teacher. Hey. Like, hey, if I get anxious, I'm just going to rip out 50 push-ups. So there's movement. And then there's also Dr. Andrew Huberman's done a lot of really, really interesting work with the connection between vision and stress and our internal state, and how our vision really, as we become stressed out, starts to narrow. And we go into what's called foveal vision, where our eyes and our gaze focus on a single point in space and time, right? Mm-hmm. And so one of the things we can do is when we notice that we're getting stressed out, we can open our peripheral vision. We can allow vision, our eyes, to relax. And so one exercise to that end is right now just to sit where you are, mm-hmm. and open your awareness to your entire visual field, including your body sitting in it. So try to keep your eyes just Don't have your eyes scan around. Just have your eyes like a soft gaze, and you're taking into account everything in your visual field at once, including your own body, right? So everything kind of zones out. That sends a direct signal to your nervous system to calm down, right?
Yeah.
This is why looking at a horizon is calming and soothing. When you look out into the distance, right, your eyes go into like panoramic vision.
Yes. Wow.
And it calms the nervous system. And so one of the things when you're on a phone all day on social media, staring and focusing your eyes, mm-hmm. and then on a computer and focusing your eyes, you're creating background ambient levels of stress hormone in your body. And so it's like your stress bucket is just filling all day because your eyes are focusing so hard.
Oh, okay. Instead of using the peripheral.
Right. Which is why you need to take breaks, eye breaks throughout the day. So set up your computer by a window so you can occasionally sit back. Like I've got two huge windows right here and lots of trees in the backyard and a nice view. And I can step back and look out the window and just let my vision open up, and it's soothing. It calms the nervous system down. So those are the real three main strategies: breathing, movement, and vision.